afternoon, everyone. This is Kevin Gianni from the Renegade Hell Show, and today might be one of the most important episodes that's ever been on the Renegade Hell Show. What do you think about that?
I love it.
Well, here's why.
What an honor.
An honor. Today is we're doing something that many people view, now, I wouldn't say it's taboo, but they view it as something that they would never do. And the intention today is to show you that it's okay, it doesn't hurt, that it's very valuable, and that it actually can be a little bit of fun. So what are we going to do? I'm going to get a colonic. I'm going to get it on the Renegade Hell Show. Now, mind you, we're not going to be showing graphic things. So we are with Shay Lynn Baird, who is our host for this week here at Santa Rosa, California. And she's an amazing raw food prep chef. Not certified, but you don't need to be certified to be really good. But she is a certified colon hydrotherapist. She's been doing it for 9 years.
It's a lot of poop. It's a lot of poop.
I was going to say that, but that was her line. It is. So let's. What are you doing today? What are we doing?
Well, in the most absolute cliff notiest layman's terms, I'm going to take a tube, which I'll show you in a moment, and I'm going to stick it up Kevin's booty. And so then water is going to go from my equipment into Kevin's body, specifically his colon, until he says that's enough for whatever reason. And there's different reasons, but whenever he's done with a fill, we're going to change the water direction to a release. So we're basically bringing water up into the colon, and when he says stop, we start a release. And with each pass, we're hopefully being able to pull out whatever particulates and stool and accumulated actual solids or waste may be in his colon. Starting with the most recent stool first, usually what is lined up and would have come out anyways next, and then you start to get to the older terrain. And then we're also, with each pass in, we're hydrating this plaster-like coating that most people have at least some degree of. Richard Anderson calls it fecal mucoid plaque, which is just a lovely name. But obviously, a standard American eater, which is a very acid-based and mucus-producing diet, is going to be very different kind of colonic than a raw food person. But even as a raw foodist, we're breathing the air that we're breathing. So I was telling Anne-Marie, we're actually living in a day and age where even Aboriginal peoples or women in the middle of the island of Australia, one of the few tribal-like people left on the planet, the women have jet fuel in their breast milk, among hundreds of other chemicals I just don't remember. So even though we're not living in New York, or I'm not living in New York or San Bernardino or somewhere where you can see the air, sorry San Bernardino, but I live a mile from a freeway, I wash my car, a day later it's covered in soot, and I'm breathing that every single day. So it's really, as Matt Monarch talks about in his book Raw Success, it's that diffusion that happens between your cells and your blood and what you're bringing into your body, either through food or through air or through emotions, and how your body stores it up and what you need to do to give your cells an opportunity to release that. And so by unburdening the colon, we actually immediately unburden the liver, which actually immediately unburdens the blood, which allows the cells to cleanse as well. So what we're looking for in the actual session is we're looking at what's in the water and then the water quality itself. So what's in the water? Poop, right? Duh. So what would have come out next, like I said, and then it starts to get older and darker and weirder and crunchier and clay-like and like gravel, potentially. There's mucus. Honestly, most people don't have what would be considered a healthy or normal-looking mucus. We're having more stuff that looks like fungus or looks like mold, and that's because that's what yeast does in an acidic environment. It's a polymorphic life cycle. It goes from a yeast into a fungus into a mold, just like from a clean aquarium to a dirty aquarium. From out of a clean aquarium comes that algae, right? So in our body, we have that kind of equivalent to algae. So we're watching that. We're seeing food and whether someone's chewing well enough or whether someone can... I saw you eat yesterday. Or whether someone can benefit from enzymes. Most people on a cooked food diet really do need to have enzymes, and that's because when you're cooking your food, you're destroying your enzymes. You can get away with a lot up until about 28 to 30 when we stop producing as many metabolic enzymes, which is what your body's borrowing to digest your food. So if you continue big, large, heavy, poorly combined cooked food meals, every meal is basically borrowing against your metabolism or borrowing against your age. There can be bile in the water. That means different things for different people. It's really difficult to tell in one session what that's going to mean. It's hard to tell a trend with one session. But Basically, it's helping to unburden your liver. It's not the kind of liver gallbladder flushing that will expunge existing stones, but it does get rid of some of the bile your body was recycling, which could have eventually turned into stones. We've got the whole parasite gamut. The protozoic family, I don't really think you can see. They're microscopic. But you're looking at different types of mucus, and it's always a good idea to cleanse a couple times a year for parasites anyways. Mm-hmm. The worm families you can see, and again, it takes more than one session usually. The small guys are burrowed into that coating, and the big guys are balled up in the cecum, which is the first portion of the colon, so it can take a while to get to where they're hanging out. So, whether you have any of these particles or particulates or not, the water may stay clear, and the longer someone's water stays clear, that's showing you levels of dehydration. If you pictured baked dry earth and you poured water on it, it would just run off at first. Eventually it would start to soak in, and you could move the earth around in your body. It starts to soak in and those layers slough off, and then the water starts to get thicker and darker. And so that's all putting together a picture of what's going on inside someone's body in a way that just pooping and looking would in the toilet would never tell you.
Cool.
That makes sense?
Yes. Okay. I want to see some yeast. I think that I still have some remnants of yeast, so I'm excited to see.
Well, hopefully you'll get some yeast. So.
Good. All right.
So we're going to let Kevin get ready, and we'll get him on the table.
All right.
World with me?
Yes.
Okay, so there are two different types of equipment. This is called a closed system, and what that's telling you is that when you release, not only is the water entering you through a tube, but you're also releasing through an enclosed tube. There's also an open system, which is a very different experience, and there's definite benefits to both. So I highly recommend that if you're just checking it out for the first time, obviously the practitioner using a system likes that system better, but make sure you know there are two types and to try them and to figure out what fits best for you, not only the therapist and his or her style and personality, but the equipment itself. It's a really good idea to check out different people if you have enough people in your area to actually check out.
Okay.
So the water's going to be about body temperature. Okay. Pressure gauge is never going to go above 2 pounds per square inch when we're filling, which we're on an empty right now, so mm-hmm. It's free to go farther. And that starts at that blue line.
Mm-hmm.
2 pounds per square inch is less pressure than if you did a gravity-based enema.
Okay.
It's going to feel different, though, because a gravity-based enema, when it enters your body, would stop at a blockage, whereas okay. This would want to keep going. Water's a little bit cooler than it should be, but I am going to just go ahead and start, if that's okay, because we're going to start the first fill. Water's going to go slowly up into the colon. I'm going to be hands-off, and then when you feel like you need to release for whatever reason, you let me know.
Okay.
And I'm going to do some abdominal massage work to move things through.
All right. So hope you guys enjoyed that. I know I did. And seriously, I did. I think that it's very important to clean out. You know, you detoxify in so many levels. This is one of them. And this is something that's important. So, you know, figure out how it works into your routine. And Shay, thank you. And
you're welcome.
Where can someone find out more information just about, you know, the process, how this works, et cetera?
You can Google your city name and colon hydrotherapist or colonic irrigation and try to find someone near you. You can always refer to my website. I have a ton of frequently asked questions and also information, and that is shaylynbaird.com. So shaylynbaird.com. And you can also go to the International Association of Colon Hydrotherapy's website, which is IACT. So IACT.org. They're sort of the governing board of colon hydrotherapists in the United States. You can put in your town, you can put in a zip code, you go to the referral list, and they'll give you anybody that's certified through IACT in your area. Again, if you have more than one to try a few till you find the person that's right for you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Your question of the day is this, post it down below. Have you done this before? Yes or no, and tell us your experience. It's okay. We give you permission to write about your poo. Kevin Gianni and
Shay Baird.
Together we can change the health of the world.
One colon at a time.